Hey folks, it's Jared Manninen from the website TahoeTrailGuide.com. In this video, I'm going to present you with a whole lot of information alongside my demonstration of mounting cross-country ski bindings to a set of cross-country skis.
This pair of skis that I'm mounting today is a backcountry and off-track variety. They're a bit wider, they have a little bit more side cut, they have a relatively aggressive scale pattern compared to a track ski, and they have metal edges. You'll also notice that these skis are much more shallow than a traditional pair of track ski. The binding that I'm going to mount to it is called NNN BC Magnum, and that stands for New Nordic Norm Backcountry Manual Binding. NNN BC is pretty standard, but there is a variety of these bindings that are an auto binding where you just step in and then press the button and step out. This one is more of a manual feature, which keeps a much tighter lock onto your boot, and it's a slightly larger binding than the NNN BC Auto. You do have to reach down to open it up to lock your boot in and remove your boot, but that's what type of bindings that I'm going to be mounting on these skis today. First off, I don't recommend most people, particularly beginners, to try to mount their own bindings onto their skis. It's probably worth more of your time and money to just go ahead and pay somebody else to do them. It's usually a pretty minimal charge, and sometimes if you buy a set of boots, bindings, ski poles, and skis, that binding process will be wrapped into the package price. The reason I would discourage you from trying to mount them yourself is simply because it does require special tools and a little bit of training. That's not to say that you can't do it. The binding manufacturer does put a template in here and kind of provides instructions, but to be honest, it's pretty minimal, and the risk that you incur by trying to mount them yourself without understanding how to do it is in my opinion, not worth it. I mostly want to show you how to do this so that you have a better idea of how those bindings, or why those bindings, are mounted where they are on the ski. The first step in mounting cross-country ski bindings to cross-country skis is to find a balance point of the skis. What I like to do is put a metal scraper, wedge it between things. In this case, it's just I got a portable table here that opens up and closes, so I just have it pinched in there. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually put the ski onto the plate here and see where we're at. All right, definitely too much weight on the tail, so we're not near there. So I move the ski forward. And now we're really getting in the ballpark here. Move it forward again. Right there, looks good. Yeah, there's a slight, you know, yawning back and forth, but that's pretty damn close. So I'm gonna take a magic marker here. I'm gonna tick where that balance point is, and I'm gonna set the ski aside. So now I'm going to take the other ski and go through the same process. Now, some manufacturers will denote on the graphic where they think the balance point is. That's fine and dandy, but if you've ever printed anything, you know that not everything prints perfect. So I'm a little bit leery about trusting what this graphic is telling me if it does in fact show a balance point. But we put that next one on there. Right there, looks perfect. So I'm gonna take my marker, I'm gonna make another line on there. So what I like to do now is take a piece of wood, just a flat edge. I'm gonna get both skis flush to that flat edge. I'll go ahead and check the front as well to make sure there's no discrepancies between them, and then you can take a straight edge, take your magic marker, and then lining up all the ticks on those skis, you can just go ahead and draw one line across both of them. Okay, now that we've marked where the balance points are on the skis, let's consider why we found that. What's so important about finding the balance point? The balance point is also known as the pin line. The pin line is where the boot actually connects to the binding, which is then connected to the ski. So the reason this is important is because if it's on balance point or pin line, For the most part, when you raise your boot to ski for diagonal striding, you're transferring your weight to that next ski, you're raising it, transferring it. The ski should act pretty natural. It should be generally level to the ground. Now, consider moving the binding just forward a little bit. What would that do? Well, as we pull our foot up, the tip is going to rise and the tail is going to drop. What could that be good for? That could be good for backcountry skiing where you're going through deep snow and you're breaking trail. This, every time you raise your foot, that tip is coming up. It gives you a little bit more control. That's awesome. Another thing to consider about the balance point, the pin line is at the front of your toe, correct? If this is the front of my toe, the tip of my finger is here, and I'm pushing down, that means I gotta push all that weight down into that pin line or that balance point. If this is a little bit forward, I can be maybe a little bit more sloppy, and now the ball of my foot is resting on the top, and that may give me more grip to go uphill. So that's one benefit of moving it forward. One, it pulls the tip out of the snow as you're breaking trail in deeper snow, but it also, when you compress your foot down onto the ski, it would, in theory, give you more grip going up. Consider the other direction if we moved the binding backwards. Instead of being on balance point or in front of balance point, we're behind the balance point. Now when we lift our feet, the tips will drop and the tails will rise. I would definitely not want this if I was breaking trail in the backcountry, because every time I put my foot up, that tip is just gonna torpedo under the snow and I am gonna be slogging forever. However, if I was going downhill, what that does is it sets my weight back a little bit from the front of the ski, and it allows me to put pressure on the back, causing the tip to rise, so now I'll get more float going downhill. And there's a whole slew of new and contemporary bindings that do allow you to make manual adjustments almost on the go. Most of them, yeah, you do have to pull your boot out of the binding, but just with a simple click of the binding, you can move it fore and aft of the balance point to accommodate that specific technique that you're looking for, whether it's more grip going uphill or more glide going downhill, forward or back, whichever you prefer. Of those three options, whether I'm on balance, in front of balance, or behind balance, personally, I like to stick to balance, keep everything kind of standardized, and then instead of making adjustments to my gear while I'm out in the field or wherever I am, I'd rather just make the subtle adjustment to me, because what I find is that nothing lasts forever. So are you really going to want to move forward and then move back to go downhill? You're going to be spending all your time monkeying around with the gear and forgetting to take a look around you. I would just rather alter my technique subtly in order to meet those changing terrain features. And realistically, that's what you should be doing no matter where you're at. Whether it's a groomed trail or in the backcountry, you should be listening to what's going on under your feet, reading the terrain to anticipate problems or hazards. You know, you should be listening to that and then just making those changes on your own subtly. So again, I lobby for just mounting the ski binding onto the ski at balance point, just keeping it simple. So now comes the terrifying part, which is putting holes in the skis.
Realistically, the only reason it's terrifying is because these backcountry type skis are pretty shallow, so there's not a whole lot of play. And then if you line up one of these screws, you think, holy cow, I'm gonna go right through the bottom. Well, if you're not careful, you will when you're pre-drilling the holes. Just to provide some contrast, this is a traditional track ski, and that screw right there wouldn't even get to the bottom had we put it directly into the top of the ski. I also like to take inventory of all the screws that come with each binding, and just because these backcountry skis kind of freak me out sometimes mounting because of how shallow they are, I'll go ahead and put the screws in there and I'll just line them up next to the side of it and see, oh yeah, that's definitely not gonna go through once it's all the way through the binding and into the top sheet of the ski. It's perfect. So I just have to make sure that the drill bit that I have has a collar that's gonna accommodate this length of screw right there. Keep in mind with the ski bits for putting ski bindings on skis, the collared bits come in different lengths. So for example, this is 3.6 by 14.5, and this one here is obviously shorter, and it's 3.6 by 9. And the reason that there's two different lengths is because they serve different purposes. On that track ski, which has a really high profile, this bit is appropriate for that. It's not going to penetrate the base when drilled through. Or if we look at the profile of this off-track backcountry cross-country ski, we could see that this bit would, you know, come right out of the bottom of the ski. We don't want that. This 3.6 by 9 is more appropriate. And you can see that collar will prevent it from sinking too deep into the ski. If you are going to do this at home by yourself, definitely make sure you have the right length of bit. I just wanted to quickly point out this longer 14.5 bit has a little black line here. That's actually the residue from black duct tape, gorilla tape, or electrical tape that I've used in the past to create a shorter bit. Essentially, what I would do is wrap the tape around that portion of the bit so that it acted like a collar, but in the end, it's a poor practice and one that I do not recommend, simply for the fact that all that tape, as you drill further down, it's going to squish that tape down, and the bit will essentially go deeper into the ski. So just buy the right bit and you'll save yourself a whole lot of hassle and stress. Another specialized piece of equipment that I use to mount skis is a jig, is called. And this one is made by Rodafella, and it accommodates NNN and NNN BC bindings. Do not try to use this one with Salomon brand bindings. They are not the same holes. They're all different. So if you're going to mount Salomon bindings, like S&S Pilot, for example, get one of Salomon's jigs. But these things are expensive, and it's another reason why I don't really recommend beginners mounting their own ski bindings onto cross-country skis. I just happened to acquire this from an old job that went out of business, and it was a great going-away present. Another reason I prefer to use a jig over doing it by hand and using one of those paper templates is for these little sleeves here. So they not only line up where you're going to be pre-drilling those holes, and essentially, you're just going to put the drill bit in it and then drill right down. And the nice thing about that is it keeps the drill bit perpendicular to the ski. If you're hand drilling, there's always that opportunity to accidentally go in sideways or at a slight angle. This just helps prevent that from happening by just sinking it straight down into the ski. I've lined up the pin line with my mark underneath here. And like the old adage goes, measure twice, cut once. What I'll tend to do is make sure all of the holes here, there's one up in the front and then there's two along here, as well as one under the ball of the foot, somewhere thereabouts, and then one for the heel. Now these types of bindings will accommodate different size boots, obviously, so you just look on the size range, 36 to 39, 40 to 43 in this example. Here I'm shooting for something a little bit beyond that, but I've already measured that on the jig, so I'm not too worried. But what I'll do is go ahead and line that up and just sight down the holes, you know. One last thing I'd like to say about using a jig over a template. These rubber grips here are spring-loaded, so this handle right here, as I undo it and do it, it's spring-loaded. So what it does is it guarantees that this jig, therefore these holes, are going to be directly center on the ski. I don't have to worry about measuring width of ski and then trying to find a center line, because the tension, so long as I have, you know, each of these placed in the same spot on both the front and the back of the ski, for example, as long as those are equal, or those holes that I'm going to be drilling in are going to be on center.
Before putting the actual bindings on, I like to dab a little bit of a wood glue into the holes. And it's not so much supposed to keep the screws from coming out, more it's to keep the water from going in. So when snow and ice tends to melt after skiing, you're not going to end up with that penetrating the screw holes into the ski. So just take a toothpick and run a little bit on there. You could even put it on the threads of the screws. That would be fine, but this is easy as anything. Two of the main options for sealing those screw holes in your skis. This has been kind of the standard for years and years, just a standard wood glue. And then lately, this silicone rubber sealant has been recommended by one of the main representatives that works with my ski resort. You can use either one, and it pretty much, again, is just there to keep snow and ice and water from getting into the holes of your ski. Another specific tool that's useful for mounting cross-country ski bindings is this PosiDrive drill bit. It's essentially a big number 3 Phillips bit, but it has these little fins in there that help drive that screw home. You can make do with this, but realistically, this is what you want to have if you're going to be mounting more than one binding. Now, to put the actual bindings on, I went ahead and began with the screws just barely popping out so then I can line them up into their appropriate holes. You might have to back them out a little bit if they feel like they're not going to go in right away. I usually try to just screw them a little bit at each time. And I like to drill them all the way down initially just because it kind of makes it uneven. At this point, I just let these things sit for a few hours to let that wood glue dry. I wouldn't want to go out and ski on them immediately, introducing snow and ice into this whole mix here. Again, let that wood glue dry before you actually go out and ski on them.
Okay, folks, I realize that was a lot of information, so I'm very grateful for those of you who have stuck around as long as you did. If you liked the video, give it a thumbs up. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. If you have any questions or feedback, post it in the comment section below, and then check out TahoeTrailGuide.com for more information. If you feel compelled to contribute in a financial way to the health and longevity of this YouTube channel as well as Tahoe Trail Guide, I offer a Patreon account for monthly contributions. I also have a PayPal and Venmo option for one-time gratuities. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time.